with that point in time on the business. I don't know what they'll come to know.
Please start, sir.
Okay. Okay, good morning to all of you. And we welcome the research person of today's lecture on historical societies in India. This is Trupti Deo,
yes.
Academic career from JNU, MA, MPhil, and PhD. After that, she joined Delhi University in 2015. She has kept herself busy teaching, research, and writing. Her articles have been published in various journals, and she has been associated with a project of University of Oregon, the United States of America. Then she has been associated with the UGC online program, that is Educational Communication of the UGC. Then she takes online classes for various organizations. And we are glad to have Mrs. Trupti Deo. Before starting our lecture, may I request Dr. Hussain to give a short introduction to the topic. Thank you very much. Dr. Shakir Hussain, please introduce the topic, then we'll start the lecture.
Sir, please unmute, sir, unmute.
Okay,
sorry. Good morning, all of you. As far as the topic is concerned, the early historic period is one of the most important part of the ancient history, because from the 6th century BC, we marked the beginning of the ancient history. And there are several criteria, several debates, several arguments why this particular time period is fixed for the beginning of the ancient history, and why this early few centuries are called as the early historic period. There are several aspects, but I don't want to go into details, as the Ms. Deo is the today's speaker. But there are few important aspects that I want to speak here. This is one of the period which the beginning of the second phase of urbanization, but initially in the Gangetic Plain region and subsequently it in different parts of the India. Then the process of urbanization, which was stopped after the Harappan, again started here. The use of the iron was very important for the proliferations of the urban cities and the development of the settlements across the Indian subcontinent. Then as for the social condition of this particular social development of this period is concerned, the class-based social hierarchy was turned into the caste-based social hierarchy, and which was fixed, and still it is continued till today. The beginning of the new social reformation movements like the Buddhism and Jainism, which caused into the development of the socio-economic and political condition of the India, and these are the patronized by different rulers and dynasties. Then the beginning of the Mahajanapadas, and in later period the power of the Magadhas and Kosala, which became later on the most powerful states among these 16 Mahajanapadas. And with the Haryanka, Shashunaga, Nandas and Maurya dynasty respectively, Magadha became one of the central power in most of the part of India. Disturbance. It resulted in the development of the systems in Indian social in Indian society. With this brief introduction, now I would like to request Ms. Trupti Deo to begin her class.
Thank you very much, Dr. Hussain, and thank you very much, Professor Mishra, for inviting me to take this section on evolution of social structures, especially to do with the 16th century BC to 4th century AD. And this is the early historic societies. I'm sure you all of you students must have done this previously also in some aspect or the other must have understood this period regarding some themes or the other. So I'm Tripti Deo. I'm associated with the Orissa's Open University for the first time, and I'm really glad to be here. I hope all of you are keeping safe and students are taking good care of themselves and making the best use of this time also. Now, Dr. Hussain has already given a brief about what this particular period, the 6th century BC to 4th century AD is like. I'm going to quickly take you through a couple of slides and through those slides highlight some main points. Now, if you look at the slide that I will be now sharing it with you is... give me a moment. If you can see the slide... I hope the slide is can be seen by everybody.
Yes, it is visible, madam.
Sorry?
It is visible.
All right. Thank you so much. So the broad themes of this particular segment are basically, we're going to cover four units. The first unit is on the urban classes, the concept of the second urbanization, where we'll be looking at the traders, artisans, agricultural settlements, and related aspects to the urbanization concept. The second theme is more cultural and religious in its orientation. If you look at what I've written, it's Chaityas and Viharas and their interaction with tribal groups. So you have to keep in your mind the emergence of Buddhism and Jainism and how it affected not only the religious minds and spirituality aspect, but then also the socioeconomic fabric of that particular period. The third unit, if you really see, is mentioned is the early Tamil society. Now, from the north and the central, we come down to the Tamil society. Through the map, I'll show the region that I'll be covering gradually through my lecture. Especially, we'll be looking at the cult of hero worship. Now, let's keep our minds and open about the hero worship. You know, hero worship is not something that is only done in the Tamil societies. You can see parallels of it across India. So maybe you can think about it while I'll be discussing the hero worship concept and the cult in the Tamil society. And the final section of this particular unit is going to be on marriage, family life, varna, jati, and untouchability. So these are things that we are living with, right? Marriage, family life. These are the social aspects that we all are oriented in and are literally facing them in our day-to-day life. So rather living it. So we will also be looking at what happened during the 6th century BC to 4th century AD on these social aspects. Now, coming to the first topic, the urban classes, traders, and artisans. Like Dr. Hussain mentioned, let's keep in our mind this particular feature of the second urbanization in India that happened at this point of time. Now, you all must be wondering, what is this? If this was second, what was the first? And I'm sure all of you must have studied this during your previous lectures, previous semesters, which is the first urbanization. The first urbanization that was the Indus Valley civilization that we actually experienced. Now, what is the second urbanization? It is a complex socio-economic process. You can't just say that cities came up and it was urbanization. It emerged gradually. It emerged amidst the rural settlements. One cannot look at urban and rural as a separate binary concept. You can't say this is urban, that is rural. You know, so there has been a major debate on what is this urban-rural dichotomy. You know, is there one or separate urban and rural? So what is important to understand is that we understand this as an urbanization process, you know, different phases of urbanization during this particular period. And 6th century BC to 4th century AD, you know, saw major developments in the urbanization process. Numerous urban centers emerged. There was a dense population around these centers. Of course, Buddhism, Jainism, the use of Brahmi script, trade flourished, both inland and overland trade. And the Chaturvarna, I'm sure you must have heard this particular concept of Chaturvarna, which is the Brahmin, Kshatriya, Vaishya, and Shudra, the four Varnas. Now, if you look at the four Varnas, the kind of importance that the that the Vaishya community or the trading community got at this point of time was phenomenal, right? So we'll also look at how the traders and artisans became a distinctive group, and they were moving up in the social ladder. When I say moving up in the social ladder, that I mean that they were through their occupation and work and significance were also raising in terms of gaining respect in society. You know, so and also the use of Brahmi script, as I've already mentioned. Now, the extension of agricultural settlement is another associated, theme under urbanization. Of course, urbanization cannot take place if we don't have agricultural produce to, you know, and surplus agricultural produce. So we see effective use of iron technology. We see agricultural settlement. So life became more sedentary and settled around the agrarian, you know, around agriculture. Effective use of iron technology, the demand and revenue actually made rulers reclaim more land, settle more villages. Yeah, and reclaim more land means that more land was brought under cultivation. I'm sure all of you know that not all land is is conducive or good for agriculture. So more reclamation of land means that more and more land was brought under under agricultural activities. Now, if you look at the South India at this point of time, the expansion, the agricultural settlements and expansion happened slightly later because of the geography of that region. So if to keep all of these things into mind, the amount of NBPW, which is North Black Polished Ware, which is also seen as one of the main source of to understand the urban dynamics of the of that particular period, we see huge hordes of NBPW, you know, at this point of time in major parts of India and a number of, you know, areas in India. Compared to the North India, in Deccan and South India, the agricultural settlements came in a bit later. Of course, because the occupation of that particular region, basic occupation was more about pastoralists and trade. Now, moving quickly towards the next particular segment, which is traders, artisans, and guild, again in the urban classes, historians like Romila Thapar have analyzed that there were certain requisites for guilds to emerge. Requisites means environment, that how will guilds emerge? Now, what is guild? I'm sure all of you know that guilds are basically, they're like trade unions. They're like unions of traders who are there to function for that particular community or that trading community that is involved, or the members of that particular community, of that particular trading occupation. So Romila Thapar says that there are three important requisites for guilds to emerge. First being localization of occupation. Second, that there should be hereditary character of professions. And third, that there should be an idea of guild leader, that this is my guild leader. Others also like UN Ghoshal, Brihaspati, Katyayani, Thapliyal, you know, all of them have worked around emphasizing on the significance of merchant and craft guilds. Now, Buddhism and Jainism played very, very significant role, especially when to support the trading, artisanal, and guild community. And you will see that because Buddhism and Jainism was more egalitarian, they supported the traders. They did not look down upon them. In fact, they supported their activities. We also see Buddhism, Jainism being supported by traders in terms of the donations that they made. We'll come to that later. There's also a debate whether the guild systems were there in the early Vedic period, like before the 6th century BC, because we have in our sources references like Shreni, Puga, etc. You know, so these are words, Shreni is guild, you know, group. So all of these terms were also be found in the sources of the early Vedic period. Decline of Mauryas gradually saw that there was a weakening control of the guilds, and the guilds therefore emerged in a big way. So of course I'm sure all of you know that the state tries to limit occupation of trades and guilds, you know, and the moment there's a weakening from the state, you know, the guilds would function and emerge in a big way, or the trading community. It's even there now. Large donations were made, and we have references from Sanchi, Barhut, and Bodh Gaya. Now these donations were made to the Buddhist and Jain monasteries and other you know, their viharas, their architectural structures. So we'll come to that later in the next section. This is a little map that I have taken from the internet. If you look at the 16 Mahajanpadas that became important capitals, kingdoms of, you know, at this particular 600 BC, they emerged in a, and there's a lot of information on this on in your sources, e-resources, you may want to look at it. So if you look at Kuru, Panchal, Koshala, Mala, Kashi, Riji, Sursena, most of them are in the northern Doab belt, the Gangetic belt. And of course, because this belt is very, very fertile, there was constant, you know, fight and of different kingdoms over land and, you know, wealth of the cattle. So Magadha was one of the major kingdoms at this point of time. And we will see that with the rise of Magadha, you know, this was also seen as one of the major development that led to the second urbanization. It actually supported and was acting as a catalyst to the second urbanization. Now, quickly moving towards some other aspects of guilds, were the guild laws which helped in functioning of the guild. They safeguarded the members, created bonds of unity among the members of the guild. Laws were based on customs and usage. And so now you must be wondering that what are these laws? Now these laws were not new to the people who were whom it was imposed on. Now the traders and merchants and the state was used to a certain arrangement, which were called the customs, yeah, the traditions. And it was based on those precedents and those customs and traditions that these laws were made. So by and large, they were recognized by the state also. Right. And then the guild structure primarily consisted of the three main elements, the General Assembly, of which all the members of the guilds were members to, the guild head, who was called the Jethika or the Pramukh, the executive officer, who actually helped the guild head in functioning of, you know, the guild. The important functions of the guild, like I've mentioned in my slide, is keeping members together, procuring raw material, administrative, charitable, and banking functions. King at times deposited money with them, you know, so king was also dependent on the guild, you know, and took loans from the guild, deposited money. So I'm just saying this very generally right now, but you can read the sources and your e-resource for specific details on that. Now, charity was a matter of duty, you know, so this was really good part of the guild that they, like what we call today as social, corporate social responsibility. Yes, every institution has a responsibility to give back to the community in certain social responsibility way. The charity was a matter of duty. Yeah. Now, one point that I would like to emphasize, which is a conceptual thing, is that there was a difference between the caste and the guild. Now, what is the difference? So let's not use these two terms synonymously, you know, thinking that they're the same. Caste is a social group. Yeah. And guild is an economic institution. Yes. So caste is, you know, it's related to the social identity of a particular person. But guild is particularly formed to fulfill a certain economic requirement. Like here, it is a trading guild. So it's an economic institution, right? Now, also, there is no reference during this period of any guild aspiring for political power, right? Like, you know, today also, like big corporate houses, they would not want to run the government, you know? So they're not interested in political power. They need economic strength. Yes. So, in fact, Kautilya at that point of time also warned the king to be tactful with dealing, you know, with the guild, because the guild, because it was economically stable, could act as a threat to the king. So, Kautilya warns the king that be tactful in dealing. Kautilya's Arthashastra, I mean. So, this is basically, you know, the first unit that so far I have tried to explain in the past, you know, 10 to 12 minutes. Let's go to the second, you know, unit of this block, which I've already mentioned, the Chaityas, Viharas, and their interaction with tribal groups. Now, I'm sure some of you must have heard this word Chaityas and Viharas, especially because Buddhism, in fact, in Odisha, we have many examples of, you know, this particular Buddhist monuments of the Chaityas and the Viharas, and, you know, many. So Buddhism, because of Ashoka in Odisha, we have a lot of monuments of Buddhist monuments of this particular, you know, period. So I'm not going to go be Odisha specific. Let's try and see the entire India in this particular context and take some, see some examples. So just a couple of points that you must keep in your mind when you're doing, when you're trying to understand Chaityas and Viharas, is that Buddhism and Jainism are the crucial point, you know. Yeah, they are, these are Buddhist and Jain monuments. Yes, and Buddhism, Buddha and Lord Mahavir both were from a Kshatriya community. So the Chaityas and Viharas are primarily, if you see, patronized by the donated, you know, dependent on the donations of these, you know, the merchant and the, you know, the merchant and the trading group. They were also, Buddhism, Jainism emerged as a reaction to Brahminism. Yeah, anti-Brahminical it was, anti-Vedic, anti-ritualistic, anti-caste, and it believed in ascetic traditions, simple living, you know. And at this point of time, of course, Buddhism is talking about an ascetic practice, a monk, a saintly practice. So we'll come to that also later. You can read about the Buddhist doctrines of the Four Noble Path, you know, the Middle Path, the Four Noble Truths, I'm sorry, the Middle Path. All of that is in the in your e-resource. Primarily, I've tried to refer that only so that when you go back after my lecture, you know, going back to your e-resource, you'll be able to, you know, relate it immediately rather than, you know, getting confused. So it has details on, you know, the precepts and the tenets of Buddhism and Jainism. Also keep a little bit in your mind information on the first Buddhist, second Buddhist and the third Buddhist council. And the third Buddhist council basically happened during the early medieval period. So that's on the timeline that we're looking at right now. Ashoka, in the modern rule, Ashoka, his efforts in propagation in and outside Indian subcontinent must be kept in mind when you are trying to understand Jainism, Buddhism per se, and to understand Chaityas, Viharas, and their interaction with tribal groups. So let's quickly move to looking at what Chaityas are. Chaitya are a pre-Buddhist sacred enclosure, originally a funeral monument, later a memorial relic. Main object of worship in Buddhism before image worship came up. So Chaitya, I'll show you a picture. Let's go to the picture. So if you look at Chaitya, there's a central monument and basically a relic, or a relic means a particular, you know, part of the body, a particular, maybe a hair or a nail. So it is a funeral monument. So for example, a Buddhist saint dies, you know, his hair strand will be preserved and kept in this particular relic, or his. So that's how the Buddha relics have also been made, you know. And Chaityas are basically, they were funeral monuments and later became a memorial relic. So this was a place for Buddhist worship before image worship came up. You also study about how image worship came with, you know, later in the Gandhara school of Buddhism and the other things. But for now, understand that, and during this period, this was the pilgrimage for Buddhists. Okay. What are Viharas? Viharas are a hall with a number of cells on all sides, with or without a veranda, simple with sparse decoration. So let me show you a picture of a Vihara cave. This is a Vihara cave in Ellora, Maharashtra. And so if you can see this, it's very bare, you know, it doesn't have too much, you know, decoration or aesthetic beauty. It's basically a complex. And look at the kind of decoration and integrities that this particular chaitya has been made. But look at the Vihara. So Vihara, of course, has a very different purpose. Now let's understand the significance of these monuments. What were they? Now, looking at them, Chaityas and Viharas, they were expressions of an organized religion. Now, Buddhism and Jainism came up in a big way during this time, and these were expressions of an organization. So for example, if you go to a temple, if you go to Jagannath temple, it is an expression of what? It is an expression of the Vaishnava religion, you know, where Lord Jagannath is the center deity. You know, so it is the temple, the Puri city, it's called the temple town, the Puri city, the Puri, you know, the temple. It's an expression. When you look at it, showcases and it tells you it, what comes to your mind is a religion, right? So if you look at Chaityas and Viharas anywhere, even, you know, here in Odisha, the Dhalagiri and, you know, the many other, you know, if you go to Khandagiri and that side, you know, you will see expressions of these Buddhist monuments. So these are expressions of organized religion. That's what it means, yeah? Now, what led to Buddhism, Jainism flourishing at this point of time? Of course, it is the monks who were traveling across, you know, India. They were dynamic monks. And also the second urbanization process, you know. So when you look at the second urbanization process, try and see it from the perspective of the Buddhism and the Chaityas and Viharas. And trade across, it never, you know, in fact, trade, new trade route open to Dakshinapath, you know. So there's details of Dakshinapath also in your source, which you can look at. Dakshinapath is going south. So there's a lot of trade that's going from north and center to the south of India. So all of this is making the entire process of urbanization a dynamic one. There were also new trade routes that open. Buddhism, of course, as I mentioned, favored the traders. It was favored by traders because Buddhism did not believe any rituals. They were not not discriminatory to traders and the Vaishya community. So therefore, the traders preferred Buddhist as a philosophy, Buddhism as a philosophy. Buddhism also emerged in a great way because of imperial patronage. And we know how the modern rulers, you know, were the first ones to really patronize Buddhism in a big way. And we can see that from the Buddhist centers that emerged at strategic locations, trade routes, urban centers like in Barhut, it's an important Buddhist center and also an urban center. In Madhya Pradesh. So gradually what we see is that religion started having expression in form of these monuments, and later we see fantastic architecture that developed, you know, as an expression. So if you look at the Lingaraj temple, for example, it's an expression of the linga, you know, a certain religion. So let's start thinking about these organized, these monuments, you know, as speaking to us, not just about how good it looks, but a certain aspect of a socio-religious, you know, life at that point of time. So let's go further to another segment of this particular unit, which is the tribal problematic. Now, what is this tribal problematic? So let's first understand that what is a tribe. Now, tribe refers to a political organization of a community. Now you may be wondering that why am I telling you about tribe? Everybody understands, but what we see, everybody understands what a tribe is, but you may confuse tribe with Adivasi. So Adivasi is also a familiar term. Now, but Adivasi is not what is tribe. Okay, now let me tell you what is Adivasi. So we know tribe is a political organization. What is Adivasi? Adivasi is actually a term that has been, it's a colonial construct. So when Britishers came in, they were trying to understand what this India is all about and, you know, what are the people and all. Now, it means aboriginals. It was used for term, it was used for a group of people or a community of people who were aboriginals. What is aboriginals? Aboriginals means somebody who is staying, or a group of people who are staying in that particular period, in that particular area from time without beginning. That means one doesn't know kab se wo reh rahe hain, you know. Matlab, aap ek timeline nahi bata sakte ho. Since the time suraj aaya, tab se wo reh rahe hain. Waise wali baat ho gayi. Since the time the sunshine came, you know, so time without beginning. So they were called aboriginals, or they were called, term that was used for these kind of people who stayed in a particular region from time without beginning. Let's remember this word, from time without beginning, were called Adivasis. right? The word tribe is more, you know, is a term which is more about a political organization. Tribe ka head hai, there's a chief of the tribe, there are other people's or members of the tribe. So it's more of a, it's samaj, political, setup hai, a political organization. I hope I'm not confused all of you to understand, but tribe is a political organization, and an Adivasi word is related to, is a term for aboriginals. Now, a tribe again is a term that we use very loosely. So it's an unstable category. Yeah. And I've already mentioned about differences between Adivasi and tribe. And the state would always have an uneasy relationship with them. And in fact, unfortunately, that's the reason why a lot of our tribes are now extinct. They're no more there because state is trying to bring them to mainstream and all. So we look at those things also later. At this particular period, third century, this particular period that we are looking at, you know, the tribes were also in a constant relationship of cooperation and conflict. 6th century BC to 3rd century, 4th century AD. Now, if you look at the 13th rock edict, and I want you to take the description of this particular rock edict of Ashokan time from your e-resource, it explains with clarity the strictness with which the Ashokan administration dealt with the tribe. Now, why are they dealing with the tribe so strictly? Because of the forest resource. The forest as a resource was an important resource for the state. Yeah. And state wanted that resource for its consumption. Yes. So they always had to deal with the tribe towards that because tribes generally stayed in the forest. Yeah, so forest was an important resource and the state wanted to take control. Sometimes even 13th rock edict talks about, you know, the state becoming ruthless towards these, you know, tribe. So take a look at this particular description of the 13th rock edict of the Ashokan inscription from your, you know, e-resource. Shirin Ratnagar, a very famous historian who's studied, you know, this particular period vis-a-vis this ethnicity and the the tribe as a social organization, you know, she says that she explains that a tribe is not ethnicity that marks a tribal. It's not that, a particular group is together, a tribal society is together because of a certain ethnic bonds, a certain commonality of, you know, birth and ethnicity. Yes, but it's a social organization. You know, so she considers it as a social organization. Everybody's together because of, in that tribe, because of a certain social construct, a social organization, which is based on egalitarianism. Okay, egalitarianism means sab ek saman hai us tribe mein. So social stratification, you know, difference bhi aaya samaj mein. The tribe, within the tribe, the social stratification at the, you know, social stratification means that differences in among the people, or, you know, the complexities that came up in the tribal society was because of many complex processes that, you know, happened over a period of time. So when you look at this period, try and understand some aspects of tribe also. Now, I'll straight away go to the third section, third unit of this particular, lecture. This is a pretty little longer, and that's the reason I would like to spend next 10 minutes or 15 minutes on this. Now, what is this particular unit is titled as Early Tamil Society, Regions and Their Cultures and the Cult of Hero Worship. Now, let's try and think about our Tamil region first. Let's bring ourselves, from the north and the central India to the southern part of India, which is the early Tamil society. So let's, at least in our imaginations on the map of India, let's bring ourselves down to the, you know, the Tamil region, yes? Because then we will be able to understand their distinctive culture and what is happening there. Because there's a huge difference because of the difference of culture, geography, and all of that. So you have to, kind of orient your mind when you are trying to see different regions. Yeah. So let's look at the early Tamil society. The four important themes that we'll be discussing in this particular, segment is the sources that are used for understanding the Tamil region, which is the Sangam literature, foreign accounts, archaeological material, Tamil Brahmi inscriptions, coins, especially the Indian and the Roman coins. Why am I saying Roman coins? Because it was flourishing Indo-European trade, especially Indo-Roman trade at this point of time. The second aspect that we'll cover is the regions and their cultures. The Tenai, which is popularly known in their literature as Tenai, T-I-N-A-I. It's written on my slide, Tenai, or fivefold landscape. Now, this is really interesting because the literature, the way the Sangam literature describes different geographical areas of Tamil region is not just its geography, but the different cultures in that region, the different. So please look at in detail, and in fact, your e-resource discusses this in many pages. So you'll be able to understand this with great detail from there. So what are these fivefold landscape? Kurinji, Mulai, Maruttam, Naital, and Palai. Yeah, I'll come to this later. The third theme is the polity. What is this polity? What is the political organization of the early Tamil society? We look at that also. And the cult of hero worship. Again, I think I've spoken about it in the beginning of the lecture that hero worship is not peculiar to South India only. My research is on Rajasthan, and we see the cult of hero worship predominantly present in the Rajasthan area, which is the western part of India. But we look at the cult of hero worship, how it emerged and what were its features in the Tamil region. Yeah, so these are the four themes that we'll be studying under this unit. Let's look at the map. I tried to tell you that try and bring yourself down south. This is the region that I was talking about. So if you look at the Cholas on your the eastern coast, Kaveri Pattanam, Nagapattanam, look at these, the important cities, Urayur. Then look at Cheras on the western coast, and the Pandyas, the deep south, the lower south, the Pandyas. So keep this in your mind, the many maps on Sangam period, which you can take from the internet. But Cholas, Pandyas, Cheras, these were the three predominant kingdoms at this point of time. They were also called Muvantas. We'll look at it a little later. Let's understand in a little detail what the sources of the Tamil region are. First, the Sangam literature. Now, the Sangam literature, the word Sangam itself is is the starting point, Sangam, the confluence, right? Now, Sangam, the period of Sangam is completely, it's still under debate. What is the Sangam age and what is the Sangam period? Generally, Sangam age has been seen from 5th century BC to 5th century AD. Okay, what is the Sangam literature? They are oral bardic literature patronized by the rulers. All right. So when I say oral bardic literature, I mean they were transmitted orally. They were not written down. Okay. They were transmitted orally from one generation to the other, from one person to the other, and they were transmitted by the bards or the poets. Yeah. And these bards and the poets were patronized by the rulers of the Sangam, the South Indian, the Tamil region. Now, let's not underestimate the power of word. Like, I'm sure a lot of people say, not everything depends on writing. Yes, writing came in later. All of these literature were documented, some of them that were preserved were documented later. But still, this bardic literature, this oral, the memory and the oral literature was useful in constructing the socio-economic and political history of that particular time. Okay, so this literature was also didactic in its nature. What is didactic? Didactic means that a literature that has some moral lessons to give. Okay, so it was the literature is written, designed for people to take something from them. Like we used to have moral science textbooks in schools, yes, netik shiksha dete, netik values, huh? So similarly, some of these literature, in fact, large number of this literature was didactic, okay? And this was designed to teach some moral lesson. But that's not the only thing. They were on many other themes also. We'll come to that later. UV Swaminatha has been instrumental in, you know, preserving, collecting, and organizing, and also publishing many of these manuscripts of the Sangam literature. Major works were 18. The minor works were 18. Now there are, you know, the terms used in the local language. Of that particular you know, region. Please look at it from the e-resource. There's in fact a lot that has been given on Sangam literature in your e-resource. There was also a very important text that was written at this point of time, which was a grammatical treatise that is referred by a lot of historians to understand this period, which is called the Tolakapyam. Okay, now I may be pronouncing it wrong because you know that language is not my mother tongue, and I'm not familiar with that, but it's called Tolakapyam. Yeah, so please look at it from your e-resource. Now coming down to the second source, important source of this period, was foreign accounts. So there have been many foreign accounts because there were foreign engagements that South India was having at that point of time, and this was primarily because of the trade, Indo-Roman trade. So a lot of merchants, traders coming from different parts of the world to India, Indian merchants and traders going to different parts of the world. So we have foreign accounts of Periplus of Erythian Sea, Ptolemy's Geographia, Roman writer Pliny's the Elder. These are some of the prominent foreign accounts and many others. There are also Buddhist chronicles, especially from Sri Lanka. So if you look at the political life of the Buddha, the Cholas, Pandyas, and Cheras, you will see that interactions and constant, you know, political relationship with the Sri Lankan rulers. So we have texts from Sri Lanka that talks about, you know, this period in India, like Mahavamsa, Deepvamsa. So they are, most of them are talking about the Indo-Roman trade, the cultural exchange, the political exchange that the three kingdoms or the rulers and the kings of the at this point of time in South are having with them, with other regions. Quickly moving to you know, the archaeological material at this point of time, I'm sure you must have heard about this word megaliths are big stone burials. Yeah, there were also many monuments that one can see for as archaeological material to understand this period. Coins, the use of coins, excavated sites, habitation sites. So habitation sites like Vasava Samundaram, you know, Kanchipuram, Arikkamedu, Kaveri Pattinam. So even if you go to these regions today, you know, these are, you will still find something culturally and socially which is an expression of the past, you know, of what we're talking about. If you go to the regions closely and see them, so they help in understanding many aspects like trade, also determining a certain chronology, because these are the earliest cities and habitation sites that were you know, that have been excavated of this period. So a lot has happened in these regions over a period of time. So we can actually see a historical trajectory and chronology and take that through, understand a particular period and many periods in these regions. Now moving further, the Tamil Brahmi inscriptions are found on the rock shelters, monuments, and pottery sites. Now they're also important as they serve as corroborative evidence for dating literature. So maybe the archaeological material can be corroborated. That means it can be testified with the Tamil Brahmi inscriptions. The Tamil Brahmi inscriptions can be testified with the Sangam, with the foreign accounts, or you know, the archaeological material on the monuments. For example, a certain inscription has been found. So it's language. So basically, a lot of engagement between these sources can be useful to understand this period. They also can be studied you know, individually. They have to be studied individually, but they also have to be studied complementing each other. Also, the coins, the Indian and Roman coins, especially from the Cheras, Cholas, and Pandyas period, the gold, silver, and the copper Roman coins, and the local coins. Now, coins especially helps us determining the chronology, because coins is a way in which the king legitimizes its power, you know, says that, okay, I'm the authority. Like today, RBI is the authority of our money, right? So every coin, every currency you will see is authenticated, authored by RBI. So it's to show a certain authority or legitimating yourself. Yes, we accept that coin that's coming from the government of India, RBI, right? So similarly, in the coins of Cheras, Cholas, Pandyas are just not simple coins. They are talking a lot about the ruler, the economy, the, you know, the prosperity or the problems and complexities of the region. So let's study these sources and think about them, you know, more dynamically when we are looking at. So this is one of the pictures of the megalith, you know, at one of these at Kadapa. Taken this from Hindu, and this is one of the recent excavations. If you look at this megalith, it's a big stone. It's a burial. So the burial is kept inside with other equipments and equipments and other things that are kept, are buried with the dead body. And then there's a huge stone. So it's like a loosely made a megalith. But it's an interesting how this pattern of megalith burial was quite unique to the Tamil and the South Indian region. Now, looking at further, this particular segment also has regions in the culture, the Tinai. I'm not going to go into details because it will take me like many lectures to finish this otherwise. The fivefold landscape, Kurunji. Now, what is this Tinai concept? I'd just like to say a couple of things about this. Now, these are five distinct ecological zones, each having separate characteristics. These five are distinct, and most of them are used for poetic compositions. So I told you that regions are just not regions. Regions are cultural regions. They have cultural, in the sense, the culture of that region is sung or expressed by the poems written by the bards and, you know, the poets at that point of time. Each Tinai also includes code of conduct. Yeah, what is this code of conduct? Akkam and Puram. Akkam is the war and Puram is love. So these are again, these themes are running through these fivefold landscape. So the poems on these landscapes reflect behavioral, you know, aspects of people. They're talking about like what are the kind of people living in Kurunji? How do they behave? You know, it's not the region only, that how good it is, or, you know, how, what are the features of the region, but it is also how the people are. So the behavior of the people, the landscapes, it actually reflects a good reality of that particular, you know, ground reality of that particular, you know, landscape. For example, Kurunji is primarily a mountainous zone. People are called Kuravan. The main occupation of that particular region is of Kurunji is hunting, gathering, and the god of Kurunji is the Muruga. Yes. So similarly, Mulai is a pastoral zone. Maruttam is a riverine zone. Nethal is a coastal zone, and Palai is a dry, semi-arid zone. So again, there are different features to what the people are called, what is the god, main god or goddess on the main occupation of these. Please take a look at it. It's given in great details in the e-resource. Akkam and Puram, basically, very interestingly, have been incorporated in the bardic sources. They're embedded in the concept of how the region is. All right. So they, most of these poems and poetic compositions are centered on common people. Yeah, these are not poems or poetic compositions, literary compositions based on a Raja or a king or in the court, telling us about the ruler and the court. But the most amazing part of these, poetic compositions, Akkam and Puram, are that they're talking about the normal people like you and I. Yes, they're talking about what is happening to them. Who are they? What are they? Yeah. So the center of the poetry are the common people. Yeah. Puram is basically, Akkam is love, the inner feeling. And Puram is the outer feeling about life, like, you know, victory, war, human values. So please look at it in a little more detail from your e-resource. Finally, in this section, in fact, there's another point left after this. Polity, I've shown you a map, Cholas, Cheras, Pandyas, they were called the Moventers. Please look at it. Please look at in your e-resource what these kingdoms were. Primarily, polity was not developed in form of great empires at this point of time. They were smaller kingdoms. It was a beginning of a very preliminary stage of a polity. Only large kingdoms were there. So there were small regions, tribal regions and all, but there were larger kingdoms which had crown kings, like who were called Venthars, and then there were smaller chieftains, like who were called Velars. The three major kingdoms at this point of time known as Moventhas, were the Cheras, Cholas, and Pandyas. Cheras, like I've shown you in the map, I don't want to go back, we'll just kill a little time. Cheras were mostly, ruled over, the present parts of Kerala and western Tamil Nadu. Yes, so Cholas ruled over the Kaveri Delta, its capital being Urayur, and I think I'd shown you that. Kaveri Pattinam, I think I'd mentioned that also, and the famous ruler was Karikala. And Pandyas were basically considered as the early rulers of Sangam age, and in fact they are credited with patronizing the Sangam poets and the Sangam age. Yeah, they ruled the southern Tamil country, and the capital being the Korkai, and so let me just take you through maybe the map. Yes, you can see that Pandyas, Cholas, and Cheras. Get back. Okay, so please look at more details about these major kingdoms and what their engagements were and dynamics were from your e-resource. The final section of this particular unit is the cult of hero worship. Now, what is this cult of hero worship? Hero worship, I'm sure everybody understands, it's quite literal. It's in the English meaning of hero, somebody who's honored. And worship is, of course, something that has been deified or worshipped. Yes. So there were different. So heroism and martyrdom were honored at this point of time. Somebody who dies in a battle, somebody who has wounds on the chest were considered brave. And so much so that somebody who has wounds on the back was considered as a coward. He was bhag ke aa gaya. तो उसके पीछे वूंड है, बैक में वूंड है, समबडी हुज बीन वूंडेड ऑन द चेस्ट एंड पर्सन हैज बीन डाइड इज कंसिडर्ड एज अ मार्टियर, इज कंसिडर्ड एज ब्रेव, यू नो, हुज फॉट फॉर यू नो अ पर्टिकुलर कॉज. सो संग पोएम्स वर संग बाय बार्ड्स एंड पोएट्स, यू नो, ऑन दीज हीरोज. व्हाई वर बैटल्स फॉट? So, because plunder as an activity was an important source to generate revenue, there is still no major way. There is revenue system, of course, that the state has, but it's not that developed. Kingdoms and especially the chieftains, the lower chiefs, you know, the not the major kingdoms, the other chiefs, they are dependent on plunder to generate revenue. So booty and plunder in kind was more important than land itself. People are not fighting for land, you know. It's basically for plunder. Plunder means basically for the booty. Booty means things that you've loot, that you've done from that particular, you know, plunder or attack. And among the booty, cattle was considered a major wealth. Cattle. Yes. So for this, basically, the war or a battle was fought. Yes. And people who soldiers who died in this were considered as hero. Yes. Now, before hero worship came in, if we have from the Vedic period references of the megalith burials, and I've already shown you a picture of megalith burial where abundant weapons have also been found with the dead. Now, the concept of hero worship or the cult of hero worship can actually be traced from the concept of the megalith tradition, you know, the megalith tradition where the dead has been buried, you know, with weapons and all of that, right? So the cult of hero worship can be traced long back in Tamil region. And but the difference is, like, let me show you a hero stone. See this. So there, this is one of the hero stones of the Pandyan kingdom that was found in Tamil Nadu. Now you will see a description of them in a certain way. Some images have been carved out, a certain thing about the war, or the description of the battle will also be, of course, not visible now. If you can see this, something has been carved out in terms of some script on the top of this particular, you know, brick. So, so if you look at this, you know, it is different to the megalith burial. Megalith burials were more bare. They were just kind of stones ko saath mein laake apne ek formation kar di. But this is more, you know, this looks more institutionalized, more closer to an expression of a particular cult. Yes, so here if you see, there are two people in this, and there's a war weapon that the person on the right has, and I think it's about attacking a particular, you know, and then there's a particular, this looks to me like a bear. So we can see that there were depictions of certain kinds in these hero stones, and of course they were decorated, they were worshipped. So the cult of hero worship is, you know, something that you can take a look at in more detail, you know, at this, from your e-resource. Now let me go to the final section of your, you know, block, which is marriage and family life, notions of untouchability, changing patterns in Varna and Jati. So I'll take next 10 minutes on this. And now this is a very conceptual, you know, it doesn't have too much fact, but it is more conceptual, and a great detail is again given in your e-resource. Please refer to that. Now there are three sections in this. First is the interpersonal relationships, gender and family life. Now what do you mean by interpersonal relationships? Interpersonal relationship within the people of the family, different persons in the family. Yes, and that may be between a man or a woman, or a mother or a son, mother or a daughter, you know, slaves and the patron, you know, the gender in family life. Now, during this entire period, you know, we've seen, you know, evolution from pastoralism to agricultural settlements, agrarian economy, commercial economy. Now, all of these evolved or different occupations of people, you know, gradually over a period of time, all these developments brought changes in social and cultural lives of people. You know, so these are just not economic developments. These were developments that shaped society and its relations. These are developments that shape the cultural mindsets of people living in that particular society. So, for example, you know, hunting, gathering, everybody used to go, all the entire family member, all the most of the, but when it came to settled agriculture, you know, there were certain people going to the agricultural field, somebody cooking in the house, you know, so then came the commercial economy. So every economic change, you know, has effects on the society and culture of the particular period. So it impacted marriages, it impacted gender relationships, it impacted family, it impacted reproduction. Okay, so Buddhist and Jain literature have spoken about, you know, women and their relations with their husbands, primarily their wifely roles, ideal conjugal life. Yes, so patriarchy, you know, the stone, the basis of on which the society is of the ancient period is, it of course becomes, you know, it's there till now also, but the base of the family at that point of time, society at large, was patriarchal. And both Buddhist and Jain literature talk about them, like the Hindu literature that we have. There were other sources like Smriti, Kama Sutra, Vatsyayana. All of these are primarily talking about the role of a good wife. You know, and there are also striking similarities in these sources. It's not that if Buddhism, you know, is different in the way it is looking at, you know, you know, this striking similarities in the way women's role are understood, conceived, you know, and portrayed in all the literature. So yes, Buddhism allowed women to come into their monasteries. Yes, that was liberating. But in terms of the literature, they're again based on the traditional roles of women, and you know. So both Hindu, Buddhist, and Jain literature are kind of talking the same thing about women, you know, which is by and large you know, based on the patriarchal society. Though the basic structure was patriarchal, we get some rare instances of royal women, you know, who were acting as sovereigns in this period. So I pulled out this example of the Bhumika dynasty in Odisha at this point of time, where several queens had occupied the throne in the absence of not having son, you know, not having an heir. So it's hard to generalize also. Yes, there was patriarchy, but there are also many examples where we see that, you know, women have taken lead and women have been given opportunity, you know, to lead in the absence of a certain traditional, you know, like here it was absence of an heir. So let's also look at some specific examples rather than generalizing ki patriarchy thi, women were considered, you know, low and all of that. So let's move away from generalizing things. You know, studying history makes us think in a more nuanced, in a more correct way. And I think that is what is important, rather than just thinking, acha, tribe to aise hi hota hai, and you know, like a tribe means this, and this is how it is. What is a tribe? What is the difference between tribe and an adivasi? So after looking at the literature on this, you must be able to differentiate and use the terms more appropriately, rather than just randomly. Similarly, just saying that society was patriarchal will be, of course, it's a generally that thing is there, but then, you know, also look at the examples that defy patriarchy, you know, in this period and otherwise also. Now, the second theme in this particular section, and I'm coming close to my lecture, just two slides left, so just bear with me for the next 5 minutes. Marriage as a facet of social reproduction. So the term marriage, everybody is familiar with. And how is it a facet of social reproduction? Now, during the Rig Vedic times, women had enjoyed an exalted position. Equality with their husbands was more there during the Rig Vedic times. And the literature has, you know, attests to these facts that I'm seeing, and I'm sure you must have also studied about the Rig Vedic period and seen that women had enjoyed equal positions with their husbands. But then gradually in the later Smriti period, there were more restrictions and the society became more rigid. Atharvaved specifically talks about 8 forms of marriages. It's mentioned in your literature. I'm not going to go into the details. Many literature, in fact, talks about many forms of marriage, ideal forms of marriage, you know, not accepted forms of marriages also. So please look at it. Despite the popularity of Buddhism and Jainism, like I said before, that gave some liberation to women in the way they were in society and family, not much had changed in the social rules related to marriage and family. So they looked at the women in similar, Buddhist and Jain literature looked at the women in similar ways, like the way Hindu literature looked at them. You know, the rules, the social rules of marriage, the social rules of how a woman should be in a family was quite similar to the way, was quite similar in all of these literatures, Buddhist, Jain, Hindu literature, where the elder male member was the patriarch who took decisions, and especially during, you know, incidences of marriage, and also during the time of, you know, marriage alliance fixing, mother did not have much role to play. And of course, the bride and the groom had no role to, you know, understand that whether they want to get married to a particular, this particular person or not. So that was a system, you know, of the marriage that happened. By and large, widow remarriage was not recommended, but it wasn't that we did not find evidences of widow remarriage. They were also not forbidden. There are some texts that do talk about, you know, that favors remarriage. So again, this is all mentioned in your resource. I'm deliberately not answering and citing many things so that you can, you know, out of curiosity, go back to your resource and, you know, take a look at that on these points. They prescribed, so they were, widow remarriage was also not completely forbidden. We have references of widow remarriage. So this is the last slide of my presentation. Changing social patterns, varna and jati. So dharma shastras are the main source from which we get information of varna concept. Now this term again, varna, must be familiar to you, the varna ashrama or the varna system. Now varna was closely associated to what is your dharma, the dharma. Majorly 4 varnas, the Brahman, Kshatriya, Vaishyas and Shudras. And the 5th category of untouchability was added later. Manusmriti prescribed occupations for respective varnas. Now, interestingly, we don't find the word varna in Buddhist literature. What is the term used in Buddhist literature? It's called jati. And of jati, there are two different kinds of jati, heena jati and ukkatada jati. So heen jati is low jati and the excellent jati is the ukkata jati. And the second term that is more popularly used in the Buddhist literature is kula. Okay, so Buddhist, the jati and kula are more popular terms than varna being used in Buddhist literature. So in reality, egalitarian principles of Buddhism really could not influence life beyond the Buddhist Sangha. So now again, the Buddhism tenets were influencing people and their mind, but by and large, these strict tenets were maintained within the Buddhist Sangha, and it really could not influence in the way we saw varna system changing, or, you know, for example, I've just spoken about how women were conceived in family and otherwise. So many developments had changed the way varna and jati evolved over a period of time. You can't say that this was one reason because of which varna became so different, or the jati behaved, the jati looked like this in a certain way. They were gradual processes. Yeah, they were evolved over a period of time, and they only became more rigid and discriminatory. So let's look at some of these developments that determined how varna and jati were. For example, the economic expansion, which had led to social integration. So we saw that how traders were now gradually being respected. You know, so they were now not considered that heen, or, you know, that they were given respectable positions. You know, so the meaning of the Vaishya Varna of the traders were gradually also gained respect. Village economy grew to becoming subsistence, from subsistence to social surplus. You know, expansion in trade and commerce. What I'm trying to say is, I'm just trying to highlight some points that led to change in varna over a period of time, in the way we look at varna and jati over a period of time. Yes, imperial polity integrated with vast regions, you know, so bigger regions were integrating smaller regions also. So there were different kinds of people coming together in the fold. So therefore, the nature and the way varna was looked at practically was also changing. Land grants to the Kshatriyas. So they expanded agricultural practices there, you know. So basically there was also new lands that were brought into cultivation. There was acculturation happening also to Sanskritic, you know, model. So therefore there were many developments that happened that had impacted the way varna and jati had evolved over a period of time. So on the whole, the hierarchical model of varna, of course, had become more rigid over a period of time. And because, of course, the society was never static, it kept moving, it kept changing. And the different features of the society had impacted in the way varna and jati were practiced in ancient India. So I think that's it from my side. I've discussed by and large, you know, the four broad themes. Let me bring you to this page. The four broad themes, which is urban classes, the Chaitya Viharas, early Tamil society, cult of hero worship, and family marriage, and the varna untouchability. So this is what I would, like to, share from this. The evolution of social structures in India through the ages, you know, at this point of time, from 6th century BC to 4th century AD. So I hope I finished in 1 hour exact, and I hand over to Dr. Sakir Hussain for his comments. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Ms. Diva. And very nice, beautiful lecture. And you have highlighted so many important points that related to the early historic period of the Indian history. And you have beautifully defined the different concepts like the agrarian economy, the urban process, then the role of the churches and viharas, and its relations with the then tribal societies. And I would like to mention one point here that, yes, we have different concepts on early historic period, And the historians and the archaeologists have the diverse of opinion. As you said, the NBPW pottery is one of the remarkable diagnostic features for the proliferation of the early historic period in the Mauryan and the pre-Mauryan time. And in the after that, it was out of scene in 2nd century BC. On the other hand, people have the comment that this particular pottery is connected with the Ramayana period. They have their controversy also. So in this manner, the historians and archaeologists are diverse in the opinion relating to the beginning of the early historic period in ancient Indian history. And even the work of Afar Alchin, M.K. Dhavlikar, Amalananda Ghosh, R.C. Rai Chaudhary, all these, they contributed a lot for this particular phase. And now at present, we have enough literature as well as archaeological evidences to prove that, yes, this period is one of the important phase. And now the concept of the urbanization of which child with his 10 points, it fulfill all those criteria. And up to the post Mauryan period, now we have a very full-faced urban civilizations in the most of the part of the Indian subcontinent, not all, because there are several regions like far off south, like Kerala, northeastern parts, and even some parts of and the Jharkhand and Orissa, which are not under this study. But more major portions, the evidences are very clear. And I am very thankful to you for your very beautiful presentation. So if any questions you may ask to Ms. Dio, otherwise we will finish this class now.
There's any comment from Professor Mishra or anybody else?
Mishra, sir, please your comments for this class of Ms. Dio. Professor Mishra?
Or if any student has any question, I think we can take it up. Or else they can also email me the questions if they would like.
Yeah.
My email address that has been mentioned.
Yeah, it is mentioned in the website.
Siddhi, am I audible?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir, you are audible.
I mean, you have actually beautifully presented an early period of Indian history, touching upon all the units, and definitely this video, which will be kept in our library, will be beneficial to students. And moreover, we'll be meeting on Saturday on another topic, 21st, 11 to 1. Yes. So we'll meet again.
Sure, sir. Thank you so much. Thank you so much.
Once again, thank you.
Thank you, Mr.
Giving the lecture, and any lecture on anything, and we are glad that you are accepting our request. So once again, thank you to all, to Dr. Sakir Hussain, to Devashish Barik, and of course, profuse thanks to Mrs. Didio.
Yes, thank you so much. And I also would like to thank the technical staff who's helped me just deal with a lot of technical things, and Dr. Zakir Hussain for being a great moderator. Thank you, Professor Mishra, for giving him the opportunity to speak on this topic. And if there's any question, if any student has today, later, any point of time, they can email it to me.
Yes, sure. They will contact you. Thank you for this beautiful lecture.
Namaskar. Thank you.
Namaskar. So, Devashish, how awkward you want to do session?